Like, the speedrun completes the game, it just does more stuff afterwards. There's an ending in the speedrun. I don't see why the ending has to be at the end of the run, so long as you get an ending. Come on. Okay. All right, we need subtitles.
God bade me behold the sea, and I saw the ship sinking and the planks floating. Then the planks too were submerged. And God said to me, those who voyage are not saved. And he said to me, those who, instead of voyaging, cast themselves into the sea, take a risk. And he said to me, those who voyage and take no risk shall perish. And he said to me, in taking the risk, there is a part of salvation. And the wave came and lifted those beneath it and overran the shore. And he said to me, the surface of the sea is a gleam that cannot be reached. And the bottom is a darkness impenetrable. And between the two are great fishes, which are to be feared. Nefari, circa 970. What?
I'm going to the store. Do you want a sandwich or something?
You've been standing there for like an hour.
I didn't want to interrupt.
And I don't like sandwiches. Have you ever seen me with a sandwich? Why would you think I want a sandwich?
Sorry.
No, I need some sleep.
Alright, I will... Wait a second.
I just want to read it right.
How does that even work?
We're gonna be hearing this...
Oh, because there are three of them.
Times.
I'm done.
Every little thing matters because it gets so multiplied.
It's good. Already good.
Thanks. Yeah. Well, we've kind of picked high goalposts. Every little bit matters. Oh, can you get me a coffee?
Thanks to the host, whoever that is. I completely missed the host message, but hey. Hello, everyone. I have not yet said hi to. Oh, God. You are just in time for the best part of the speedrun, followed by the second best part of the speedrun. The best part is Hall of the Mountain King. The second best part is Food Break. Also, I guess my split from Mountain no longer really makes sense, so I'm just gonna skip it. But okay, Army, I have no idea what this is, but I'm glad it's here. Welcome, Raiders. Welcome, welcome. No, I do not have these memorized. I'm furiously looking to the side at my notes without actually looking dumb. And it's working. But we're about to get to the part of the run that actually requires skill. It'll be a good time. I can't do it. There we go. Then the pillar. This raid is reasonably strong. Okay, let's see if I can remember how to do this, because it's difficult. Okay, go up. Race all those. Nope. No. There it is. There it is. Okay. That's not it. I don't even remember where this is a shortcut. Oh, now I do. Never mind, I lied. I mean, I guess I didn't quite lie. But I came very close. This is supposed to go down. Oh my god. So this is called a raid. It is when somebody stops streaming and says, "Hey guys, go over there." And then they post stuff to say, "Hey, we're here." And it, everyone is happier for it. The lag, I can't even. Alright, are you guys ready? It's that time. It's technically faster to do this a little bit later, but like, I don't care. I can't just like pass by here and not do it. That would be silly. Wait. Where is it? It's like right here? Yeah. Alright. Let us begin. That's easy. Oh my goodness, how do you even? How do you even? Okay. Okay. Ooh, that one was touchy. That one was not what I thought it was. Okay. They're outside. They cannot be outside, they have to be inside. What? Okay, so it's those plus that. Which I literally can't do. That's necessary. Okay. Okay. Jesus Christ, that took me forever. That one's impossible. It's this one. Oh my god. Okay, I thought that was the end of it, and I was like, nope, 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 but we're fine. Let's see. That's not a thing. This It literally cannot be the middle one. Oh my god. There it is? No. It can't be, right? It's literally impossible. Yeah, it's literally impossible. I get it. Alright, so we go right, up, right, 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 up. I could have sworn. Alright, it's pretty over. I'm just saying, it's pretty over right now. It's pretty darn over. Excuse me? Okay. There's hope. Game, please. Oh my god. Did it, boys? Did it, boys? Oh my goodness. Woo! That's a trip. I'm literally on a 3-win streak on challenge, by the way. Those consist of my first casual completion and 2 speedrun completions. Oh my god. Okay. We did it. We did it. Do you go up? You go up, right? Yeah, you go up. Are you guys ready for food break? I'm excited for food break. If food's not your thing, there's a great talk you get to listen to. Like, this is basically, like, this is the greatest point of the run. The reward for passing through Hall of the Mountain King is literally food. I approve. And we're almost there. I can taste it. It's like midnight or something. So the only place open that I know of that I actually like is Whataburger. Which is fine, because Whataburger is delicious. We also have not yet done Cloud. I have to wait for Cloud. Let's see. I'm gonna try that. I mean, this is the time to do it. Am I late? I'm late.
A worm? Or a geranium? Or you?
I'm late.
This stuff's easier to take.
I'm not late. I am, in fact, right on time. Alright, so stuff that I have yet to do are the one up here, Eclipse, Clouds, and Endgame. That's all that remains in the speedrun. Obviously, we're doing Eclipse right now because it's right here. And I need to remember Clouds and then Endgame. It's not difficult. Also, I love how he just stares at you down this long hallway. Alright. Which of these was it? It is...
trying to find
this one.
At one time, commercial district. But like so many other New England cities,
right,
the advent of shopping malls had, by the early 70s, turned it into a ghost.
I'm getting food.
Wister's solution to
this takes 58 minutes,
decisive, to say the least.
Roughly.
The city's elders apparently decided.
I've never waited through this before.
Them,
I'm excited.
They would join them.
I'm literally going
so,
to get in my car, drive like
city,
15 minutes to Whataburger. Get probably a fish sandwich, actually, because I had a burger for lunch.
Including the site of a pharmacy.
I'm going to come back here. I'm going to eat it on webcam.
In their place was erected a vast three-level
shopping complex with cinemas
and a food court. It's
going to be delicious. We'll be back in like 20 minutes.
A few forlorn blocks of the old Wister remained standing. My Radio Shack store was in one of those blocks.
Also, this talk is from GDC from like 2002, and it's really good. Like, staying and listening to this is not a bad idea.
Less than 500 feet from my store.
If anybody wants to donate and not have me read it out, this is a great time.
Well-lighted establishment with uniform security,
hello, Snowy.
And acres of convenient parking, or a shadowy hole.
I'll be back in like 20 minutes. Like a third of this, you have to wait by yourselves. I'll be back.
Consequently,
I'll be back.
I had plenty of time to fool around with the new computer.
I'll be back.
I taught myself basic programming. Then I learned Z80 assembly. Both, of course, so that I could write games. I also created self-running animated demos, which ran all night in the store window for the edification of the winos who peed in our doorway. Strangely enough, the few customers we had didn't seem to be interested in our new computer, even after the 16K memory upgrade. In fact, most of the people who set off the buzzer on their way through the front door weren't there to buy anything at all. They were there to exploit a free promotion, which was the bane of Radio Shack employees for over 40 years. The Battery of the Month Club. The idea of this promotion was simple. Customers got a little red card upon which was printed a square for each month. 12 times a year, the lucky sales clerk got to punch out a square and give the customer one brand new AAA, AA, C, D, or 9-volt battery. Of course, customers weren't allowed to choose just any grade of battery. At the time of my employment, Radio Shack offered three different levels of battery excellence. First were the alkalines, powerful, long-lasting, and expensive, hanging behind the counter like
found some money.
Medication in gold-embossed blister packs. These were most certainly not available through the Battery of the Month Club. Next were the high-end lead
found
batteries,
some money.
Sturdy, dependable batteries, moderately priced, and prominently displayed near the front of the store. These were also not available through the Battery of the Month Club. Finally, at the bottom of the barrel were the standard lead batteries. These were literally piled in barrels, cunningly located way at the back of the store, in a dark corner near the TV antennas. Remember TV antennas? Customers who came in looking for their free battery of the month had to walk the entire length of the premises, past the CB radios and stereo headphones and remote-controlled racing cars. Nothing would stop them. On the first day of every month, like clockwork, those customers came in waving their little red cards. I would look up from my programming and wave them to the back of the store. It didn't matter that the batteries were only worth 29 cents. It didn't matter that most of them were already half dead. They came, they grabbed. And as far as I can remember, not one of them ever paid for a damned thing. I was such a crappy salesman. I was young and foolish. I thought my education in game design was happening at the keyboard. I almost missed the lesson coming through the front door. Fortunately, I wasn't the only person fooling around with games on micros. All over the country, people like me were experimenting. Scott Adams was coding what would soon become the world's first commercial adventure game. Remember adventure games? My future employer, Infocom, was being founded, along with other legendary companies like Online Systems, Sirius, Personal Software, and SSI. Those were exciting times. Teenagers were making fortunes. Games were cheap and easy to build. The slate was clean. But in 1979, the biggest news in gaming had nothing to do with computers. On the morning of the autumn equinox, September 20th, a new children's picture book appeared in the stores of Great Britain. This picture book was rather peculiar. It consisted of 15 meticulously detailed color paintings, illustrating a slight whimsical tale about a rabbit delivering a jewel to the moon. On the back jacket of the book was a color photograph of a real jewel, shaped like a running rabbit, 5 inches long, fashioned of 18 karat gold, suspended with ornaments and bells, together with a sun and moon of blue quartz. According to the blurb underneath, this very jewel had been buried somewhere in England. Clues pointing to its location were concealed in the text and in the pictures of the book. The treasure would belong to whoever found it first. The book was called Masquerade. It was created by an eccentric little man with divergent eyes and a talent for mischief named Kit Williams. Within days, the first printing was sold out, and the empire that never sleeps found itself in the grip of rabbit fever. Excited readers attacked the paintings with rulers, compasses, and protractors. Magazine articles and TV specials dissected the clues, floated theories, and followed with keen delight the reckless exploits of the fanatics. One obscure park, unfortunately known by the nickname Rabbit Hill, was so riddled with holes excavated by misguided treasure seekers that the authorities had to erect signs assuring the public that no gold rabbits were to be found there. Some hunters ended up seeking psychological counseling for their obsession. The craze leapt over the Atlantic Ocean and invaded America, France, Italy, and Germany. It sold over 1 million copies in a few months, a record unrivaled by any children's title until the advent of Harry Potter. Over 150,000 copies were sold in foreign translations, including 80,000 copies in Japanese, despite the fact that the puzzle was only solvable in English. It didn't matter that the Masquerade jewel was only worth a few thousand dollars. Many seekers spent far more than that in their months of exploration and travel. It was the thrill of the chase, the possibility of being the one. Treasure hunts, secret messages, and hidden things seem to exert an irresistible appeal. They're fun to look for and to talk about. And this fact of human psychology has been exploited in computer games since the earliest days. It finds expression in the hidden surprises we call Easter eggs. Atari's Stephen Wright is credited with coining this term in the first issue of Electronic Games magazine. The first Easter egg in a commercial computer game appeared in an early Atari 2600 cartridge called, simply enough, Adventure. By a sequence of unlikely movements and obscure manipulations, players could discover a secret room where the words "created by Warren Robinette" appeared in flashing letters. Over the decades, Easter eggs and their evil twin, cheat codes, have become an industry within an industry. Entire magazines and websites are now devoted to their carefully orchestrated discovery and dissemination. They're part of our toolkit, our basic vocabulary, the language of computer game design. Computer gamers may have been the first to refer to hidden surprises as Easter eggs, but we certainly weren't the first to use them. Painters, composers, and artists of every discipline have been hiding stuff in their works for centuries. The recent advent of VCRs and Laserdisc players with freeze frame capability exposed decades of secret Disney erotica. Thomas Kincaid, the self-appointed painter of light, amuses himself by hiding the letter N in his works. A number beside his signature indicates how many N's are hidden in each painting. Picasso, Dali, Raphael, Poussin, and dozens of other painters concealed all kinds of stuff in their paintings. A favorite trick was hiding portraits of themselves, their families, friends, and fellow artists in crowd scenes. El Greco loved dogs, but the Catholic Church forbid him from including any in his sacred paintings. So he hid them, usually within the outlines of celestial clouds. Composer Dmitri Shostakovich chafed under the political censorship imposed by the Soviet Ministry of Culture. His symphonies and chamber works are loaded with hidden signatures and subversive subtexts, which, had they been recognized, would have sent him to Siberia. Mozart's opera, The Magic Flute, is filled with musical allusions to the rituals of the Freemasons, the ancient secret society of which he and his mentor Haydn were members. But the most famous purveyor of Easter eggs is that champion of the late Baroque, the ultimate musical nerd, Johann Sebastian Bach. Bach was a student of gematria, the art of assigning numeric values to letters of the alphabet, A equals 1, B equals 2, C equals 3, etc. By comparing, sequencing, or otherwise manipulating these numbers, secret messages can be concealed. Bach took particular delight in the geometrical numbers 14 and 41. 14 is the sum of the initials of his last name, B equals 2, A equals 1, C equals 3, and H equals 8. 41 is the sum of his expanded initials, J.S. Bach. These two numbers show up over and over again in Bach's compositions. One of the better known examples is his setting of the chorale Vor deinem Thron. The first line of the melody contains exactly 14 notes, and the entire melody, from start to finish, contains 41. Another of Bach's favorite games was the puzzle canon. A canon is a melody that sounds good when you play it on top of itself, a little bit out of sync. Frère Jacques and Row, Row, Row Your Boat are familiar examples of simple, two-voice canons. But a canon can employ any number of voices. And you don't have to play each voice the same way, either. You can change the octave, transpose the key, invert the pitch, play it backwards, or any combination. Finding melodies that make good multi-voice canons is a fussy and difficult art, of which Bach was an undisputed master. Now, in a puzzle canon, the composer specifies the basic melody and the number of voices, but not the relationship of the voices. The student has to figure out the position and key of each voice, and whether to perform them inverted and or backwards. Bach wrote quite a number of puzzle canons. The most famous, BWV 1076, is part of a fascinating story. One of Bach's students was a fellow by the name of Lorenz Misler, founder of the Society of Musical Science, This elite, invitation-only institution devoted itself to the study of Pythagorean philosophy and the union of music and mathematics. Its distinguished membership reads like a who's who of German composers, including Handel, Telemann, and eventually Mozart. Applicants for membership in the society were required to submit an oil portrait of themselves, along with a specimen of original music. With nerdly efficiency, society member number 14 decided to combine these admission requirements into a single work. He sat for a portrait with Elias Hausmann, official artist at the court of Dresden. This portrait, which now hangs in the gallery of the town hall in Leipzig, is the only indisputably authentic image of Bach in existence. The Hausmann portrait shows Bach dressed in a formal coat with exactly 14 buttons. In his hand is a sheet of music paper, upon which is written a puzzle canon for 6 simultaneous voices. In 1974, a manuscript was discovered which proved that this canon was the 13th in a series of exactly 14 canons based on the ground theme of the famous Goldberg Variations. As if these musical gymnastics weren't enough, Bach liked to hide messages in his compositions by assigning notes to the letters. His initials, B-A-C-H, correspond to the pitch sequence B-flat, A, C, and B-natural in German letter notation. This theme makes its most memorable appearance in the last bars of his final composition, The Art of Fugue, published soon after his death in 1750. The word fugue comes from the Latin fuga, which means flight, as in running away. So the Art of Fugue is the art of flight, the art of taking a theme and running with it. Bach wrote hundreds of fugues, but none as sublime as this sequence of 14. In the last and most complicated fugue in the series, the first and second sections develop normally. This is followed by the BACH signature, and then suddenly, without any warning or structural justification, the fugue stops, dead in its tracks. One of the composer's 20 children, his son Carl Philipp Emanuel, claimed that Bach died moments after those last few notes were written. This story is probably apocryphal. The Easter eggs in Bach's music are a pleasant obscurity, known chiefly to professors and students of Baroque music. But in March of 2002, when this lecture was first delivered, those Easter eggs were the talk of the entire classical music industry. Sitting near the top of the classical music charts that month was a compact disc on the ECM label called Morimer. It was performed by the Hilliard Choral Ensemble, together with a talented but, until then, little-known violinist, Christoph Poppen. The music on Morimer is based on a geometriacal analysis of Bach's Partita in D minor for solo violin. This analysis, by German professor Helga Thon, assigns numeric values to the duration of notes, the number of bars, and the German letter notation of the partita. In doing so, she claims to have discovered the complete text of several liturgical ceremonies encoded in the notes. The CD presented these hidden texts superimposed over the original music. The result was strangely melancholy, dark, haunting, and very, very popular. Quite a few music critics attacked this disc. They didn't buy Professor Thone's analysis, dismissing it as a combination of numerology and canny marketing. Their caution was not without basis. Numerology is a slippery slope down which many a fine mind has slid to its doom. Allow me to offer an amusing anecdote from my own experience. Back in the early 90s, before the internet took off, one of the more popular online bulletin board systems was a service called Prodigy. I bought an account on Prodigy so I could join a fraternal interest group and gossip with fellow members around the country. One day, a stranger appeared on our bulletin board. Right away, I knew we were in trouble. This fellow, whose name was Gary, began spouting all kinds of apocalyptic nonsense about worldwide conspiracies, secret societies, and devil worship. At first, we tried to be polite. We questioned his sources, corrected his histories, logically refuted his claims, and tried to behave in a civilized manner. But instead of soothing him, our attention only made him worse. His conspiratorial warnings became urgent, approaching hysteria. He began to threaten people who disagreed with him. To coin a phrase, Gary went all uppercase. But his most urgent warnings weren't about the gays, the Jews, the Rockefellers, or the Illuminati. According to Gary, the greatest enemy of mankind was Santa Claus. Gary claimed to possess a secret numerical formula that proved, beyond a shadow of a doubt, that Santa Claus was an avatar of the Antichrist. Intrigued, we pressed Gary to reveal his formula. In doing so, we walked right into his trap. We should have known he had a book to sell. I fell for it. I sent him the $15. Less than a week later, the book arrived. Above an ominous photograph of the Washington Monument was emblazoned the title, 666, The Final Warning. Inside this privately printed 494-page monster, Gary reveals a simple geometrical formula, which he claims was developed by the ancient Sumerians. This formula assigns successive products of six to each letter of the alphabet. A equals 6, B equals 12, C equals 18, etc. Imagine my dismay when I applied this ancient formula to the name Santa Claus and obtained the blasphemous sum of 666, the biblical number of the beast. I went on Prodigy and reported to the stunned members of our interest group that Gary was right after all. There could be no doubt that according to the unimpeachable wisdom of ancient Sumeria, Santa Claus was the Antichrist. I then went on to point out several other names which, when submitted to Gary's formula, also produced the sum 666. Names like St. James, New York, and New Mexico. Soon the bulletin board was filled with discoveries like computer, Boston Tea, and most sinister of all, sing karaoke. Gary left us alone after that. I got my $15 worth. But Gary is hardly the first person to connect secret codes to the Bible. People have been looking for Easter eggs in the Bible for hundreds of years. The Hebrew mystical tradition of Kabbalah can be described as a gematriacal meditation on the Pentateuch, the first five books of the Old Testament. The advent of computers has made the application of numerology to the Bible fast and efficient. The latest spate of Bible searching was instigated by a book published in 1998 by Michael Drosnin, a former Wall Street Journal reporter. His book, The Bible Code, applied a skip cipher in which every nth character in a text is combined to form a message. By applying his skip cipher to the Hebrew text of the Old Testament, Drosnin claimed to have discovered predictions of World War II, the Holocaust, Hiroshima, the assassination of Yitzhak Rabin and both Kennedys, the moon landing, Watergate, the Oklahoma City bombing, the election of Bill Clinton, the death of Princess Di, and the comet that collided with Jupiter. He also found predictions of a giant earthquake in LA, a meteor hitting the Earth, and nuclear Armageddon, all scheduled to occur before the end of the last decade. The Bible Code spent many weeks on the bestseller lists, spawning several sequels and dozens of imitators. The Bible has certainly attracted its share of crackpots. But for the real hardcore egg hunters, nothing can rival the ingenuity, the tenacious scholarship, the stubborn zeal of those who seek the answer to the ultimate literary puzzle. A poisonous conundrum that has squandered fortunes, destroyed careers, and driven healthy, intelligent scholars to the brink of madness and beyond. Who wrote Shakespeare? The essays and books devoted to the Shakespeare authorship problem are sufficient to fill a large library. Several such libraries actually exist. Not even a day-long tutorial, much less an hour lecture, can begin to do justice to this complex, bizarre, and dangerously tantalizing story. Nevertheless, for the unacquainted, I will attempt to summarize the issue in a few paragraphs. The undisputed facts of Shakespeare's life and career could be scribbled on the back of a cocktail napkin. We know for a fact that a man named William Shakespeare was born in 1564 in or around the village of Stratford-upon-Avon. We know that he had a wife and at least three children. We know he bought property in Stratford, was involved in several lawsuits with his neighbors, and died there in 1616, aged 52. We also know that during those same years, a man with a last name similar to Shakespeare worked as an actor on the London stage, eventually becoming co-owner of some of the theaters there. We also know that about the same time, a number of most excellent poems and plays were published in London under the name Shakespeare. We do not know for a fact that the landowner in Stratford and the actor in London with a similar last name were one and the same man. We do not know for a fact that either man had anything to do with the poems and the plays. All we know is that those poems and plays have, in the 400 years since their composition, come to be regarded as a pinnacle of Western culture. The works attributed to Shakespeare appear to have been written by a man or woman who knew something about just about everything. They're filled with references to mythology and classic literature, games and sports, war and weapons of war, ships and sailing, the law and legal terminology, court etiquette, statesmanship, horticulture, music, astronomy, medicine, falconry, and, of course, theater. Therein lies the problem. How could a farmer's son of uncertain schooling, from a mostly illiterate country village, a man of practically no account at all, wield such encyclopedic learning with so much eloquence and wit, so much wisdom and human understanding? For the first 150 years, nobody questioned the traditional history of the bard. Then, in the late 18th century, Reverend James Wilmot, a distinguished scholar who lived just a few miles north of Stratford, decided to write a biography of the famous playwright. Dr. Wilmot believed that a man as well educated as Shakespeare must have owned a fairly extensive library, despite the fact that not a single book or manuscript is mentioned in his will. Over the years, he speculated, some of those books must have found their way into local collections. And so, the good Reverend Doctor scoured the British countryside, taking inventory of literally every bookshelf within 50 miles of Stratford. Not a single book from the library of William Shakespeare was discovered. Neither were there found any letters to, from, or about Shakespeare. Furthermore, no references to the folklore, local sayings, or distinctive dialect of the Stratford area could be found in any of Shakespeare's writings. After 4 years of painstaking research, Dr. Wilmot concluded, to his own dismay, that only one person contemporary with Shakespeare of Stratford had ever demonstrated the wide-ranging education and expressive talent needed to compose those poems and plays. That man was the multilingual author, philosopher, and statesman, inventor of the scientific method, chancellor to the courts of Queen Elizabeth and King James, Sir Francis Bacon. Dr. Wilmot never dared to publish his theory. But before he died, he confided it to a friend, James Cowell, who, in 1805, repeated it to a meeting of the Ipswich Philosophical Society. The members of the society were suitably outraged, and the scandalous matter was quickly forgotten. Then, in 1857, a lady from Stratford, Connecticut, published a book called The Philosophy of the Plays of Shakespeare Unfolded. In this book, Miss Delia Bacon, no relation to Francis, claimed that the works of Shakespeare were written by a secret cabal of British nobility, including Sir Walter Raleigh and Sir Philip Sidney, as well as Sir Francis Bacon. Delia Bacon's book electrified the world of letters. Battle lines were drawn between the orthodox Stratfordians and the heretical Baconians. Literary societies and scholarly journals were formed to debate the evidence. Hundreds of pamphlets, newspaper articles, and essays were published defending each side and ridiculing the opposition with that self-aggrandizing viciousness peculiar to tenured academics. Armed with her explosive book, Delia Bacon journeyed to Stratford-upon-Avon and, unbelievably, obtained official permission to open Shakespeare's grave. However, when the moment came to actually lift the stone, Delia's self-doubt precipitated a catastrophic nervous breakdown. She later died penniless in a madhouse. Around 1888, things began to get a bit out of hand. U.S. Congressman Ignatius Donnelly of Minnesota became interested in the Shakespeare controversy. One day, browsing through his facsimile copy of the first folio of 1623, he noted that the word bacon appeared on page 53 of the histories and also on page 53 of the comedies. He also noted that Sir Francis Bacon had written extensively on the subject of cryptography. Donnelly began counting line and page numbers, adding and subtracting letters, drawing lines over sentences, circling words, and crossing them out. The result was a complex and virtually incomprehensible algorithm, which he claimed was invented by Bacon to hide secret messages inside the first folio. The greatest Easter egg hunt in the history of Western civilization had begun. Here are just a couple of the sillier highlights. A doctor named Orville Owen of Detroit constructed a bizarre research tool he called the Wheel of Fortune. This wheel consisted of two giant wooden spools wrapped with a strip of canvas 2 feet wide and 1,000 feet long. Onto this canvas, he glued the separate pages of the complete works of Bacon, Shakespeare, Marlowe, Green, Peele, and Spencer, together with Burton's Anatomy of Melancholy. By cranking the spools back and forth, Dr. Owen could quickly zip across the pages in search of clues and cross-references. Employing a large team of secretaries and stenographers, Owen claimed to have uncovered a complete alternative history of Elizabethan England, as well as several entirely new Shakespeare plays and sonnets. Listen to this hidden verse, supposedly penned by the mighty bard himself, which inspired Dr. Owen to build his Wheel of Fortune. "Take your knife and cut all our books asunder, and set the leaves on a great firm wheel, which rolls and rolls, and turning the fickle rolling wheel, throw your eyes upon Fortune, that goddess blind, that stands upon a spherical stone, that turning and inconstant rolls in restless variation." After publishing 5 thick volumes of this rubbish, Owen announced the discovery of an anagram, indicating that Bacon's original manuscripts were buried near Chepstow Castle on the River Wye. Owen spent the next 15 years and thousands of dollars excavating the bed of the river with boat crews and high explosives. He died before anything was found. A fellow named Arnsberg wrote an entire book based on the analysis of the significance of a suspicious crack in the tomb of Bacon's mother. A ray of sanity finally appeared in 1957. To those familiar with the science of cryptology, the name William Friedman needs little introduction. During World War II, Colonel Friedman was the head of the U.S. Army's Cryptoanalytic Bureau. He is credited with cracking the Japanese Empire's most sensitive cipher. After the war, the colonel decided to apply his expertise to the study of the Shakespeare ciphers. He interviewed several of the experts in the field and prepared a detailed scientific analysis, which he published under the title The Shakespeare Ciphers Examined. His conclusion? In a word, bunk. According to the standards of cryptologic science, not one of the hidden messages purportedly discovered in Shakespeare's works was plausible. The rules used to extract these messages from the texts were non-rigorous, wildly subjective, and unrepeatable by anyone except the original decipherer. The people involved were not being dishonest. They were channeling their preconceptions. They were trapped in a labyrinth of delusion, mining order from chaos. Anglers in a lake of darkness. Lear, Act 3, Scene 6. You would think that Friedman's cold and ruthless exposure would be enough to silence the heretics once and for all. Not a chance. The books and TV specials and websites and conferences and doctoral dissertations keep right on coming. I should point out that the Shakespeare authorship issue is not only the preoccupation of cranks and weirdos. A substantial number of respected authors and Shakespeareans have expressed serious doubts about the traditional origin of the plays. The list includes
Hawthorne,
Ralph Waldo Emerson,
I brought Walt with Whitman, me some napkins,
Henry James, Sam Clemens, Sigmund Fries. Freud, Orson Welles, and Sir John Gielgud.
And a fish sandwich.
Living skeptics include the artistic
director. Will undoubtedly
of the
be delicious.
Theater, Mark Rylance.
I'm going to do you guys a favor of muting my microphone as I eat, because as much as I like memes, that sucks.
Scholarly of contemporary Shakespearean actors, Keanu Reeves.
So I'm just going to eat now.
The current leading candidate for the authorship is Edward de Vere, the 17th Earl of Oxford, a theory first proposed in 1920 by an English schoolmaster with the unfortunate name J. Thomas Looney. What is it about Bach, the Bible, and the works of Shakespeare that inspires this intense scrutiny? Nobody's looking for acrostics in Chaucer or Keats. There are no hit CDs of the secret chorales of Wagner or Beethoven. For the answer, we need to recognize the unique roles which the Bible and Shakespeare have played in the development of Western culture. No other single work of literature has influenced modern English more than the translation of the Holy Bible published in 1611 under the auspices of King James I. The King James Bible exemplifies the meaning of the word classic. It has been called the noblest monument of English prose, the very greatest achievement of the English language. It has served as an inspiration for generations of poets, dramatists, musicians, politicians, and orators. Countless people have learned to read by repeating the phrases in this, the only book their family possessed. Our constitutions and our laws have been profoundly shaped by its cadences and imagery. But even the glory of the King James Bible, compiled by a committee of 46 editors over the course of a decade, pales before the dazzling legacy of the Swan of Avon. The lowest estimate of Shakespeare's working vocabulary is 15,000 words, more than three times that of a King James Bible, and twice the size of his nearest competitor, John Milton. His poems and plays were written without the aid of a dictionary or a thesaurus. They didn't exist yet. It was all in his head. When Shakespeare had a thought for which Elizabethan English had no word, he invented one. The Oxford English Dictionary lists hundreds of everyday words and phrases which made their first appearance in the pages of the Bard. Addiction, alligator, assassination, bedroom, critic, dawn, design, dialogue, employer, film, glow, gloomy, gossip, hint, hurry, investment, lonely, luggage, manager, switch, torture, transcendence, wormhole, zany. Hamlet alone contains nearly 40 of these neologisms. Who today would have this audacity, this giddy exuberance of invention? Only one other English author even approaches Shakespeare's facility for coining new words: Sir Francis Bacon. In the modern era, the record holder is Charles Dodgson, better known as Lewis Carroll, who, interestingly, also happens to be the second most quoted author in English, after Shakespeare. Everyone has been profoundly molded by the influences of the King James Bible and Shakespeare. Like it or not, all of us peer at the world through the lenses of these great works. They are the primary source documents of modern English thought, the style guides of our minds. Contemplating these dazzling jewels of wisdom and eloquence gives rise to an extraordinary feeling, a potent, rare, and precious emotion with the potential to completely upset your life. An emotion powerful enough to make a man abandon his wife and children, forfeit career and reputation, lay down his possessions, and follow his heart without questioning. That sweet, sweet fusion of wonder and fear, irresistible attraction and soul-numbing dread known as awe. Awe is the grail of artistic achievement. No other human emotion possesses such raw, transformative power, and none is more difficult to evoke. Few and far between are the works of man that qualify as truly awesome. It is awe that convinces a rabbi to spend a lifetime decoding Yahweh from the Pentateuch. Awe that sends millions of visitors each year to the pyramids of Giza, Guadalupe, and Mecca. It was awe that drove poor Delia Bacon to her doom. Now, please don't come away from this lecture thinking that the key to awesome game design is the installation of Easter eggs. Ordinary games with their contrived Easter eggs and cheat codes are like the Battery of the Month Club. You have to trudge down to the back of the store to get what you really came for. If superpower is what people really want, why not just give it to them? Is our imagination so impoverished that we have to resort to marketing gimmicks to keep players interested in our games? Awesome things don't hold anything back. Awesome things are rich and generous. The treasure is right there. One afternoon, I was sitting alone behind the counter at that old Radio Shack store. My boss had stepped out for some reason. An elderly woman walked through the front door. Like most of our customers, she was shabbily dressed, probably on a fixed income. I assumed she was there for her free battery, but instead, she placed a portable radio on the counter. This little radio came from the days when they boasted about the number of transistors inside on the case. It was completely wrapped in dirty white medical tape. The woman looked at me and asked, "Can you fix this?" Slowly, I unwrapped the medical tape, peeling away the layers until the back cover of the radio fell off, accompanied by a cloud of red dust. The interior of the radio was half eaten away by battery leakage and corrosion. I looked at the radio. I looked at the old woman. I looked back at the radio. I reached behind me, where the expensive alkaline batteries were hanging like prescription medication, and removed a gleaming 9-volt cell from its gold blister pack. Then I pulled a brand new transistor radio from a box, installed the alkaline, and helped the lady find her favorite station. No money changed hands. She left the store without saying a word. Awesome things are kind of like that. Bach offered his students very specific insight into the source of awe. In addition to B-A-C-H, two other sets of initials are also associated with Bach's music. These initials are not hidden in the notes. Instead, they're scrawled right across the top of the manuscript for the whole world to see. The initials are S-D-G and J-J. S-D-G stands for the Latin phrase Sole Deo Gloria, to the glory of God alone. JJ stands for Jesu Juva, help me, Jesus. Bach wrote all of his great masterpieces Subspecie Aeternitatis, under the aspect of eternity. He did not compose only to please his sponsors or to win the approval of an audience. His work was his worship. Bach once wrote, "Music should have no other end and aim than the glory of God and the recreation of the soul. Where this is not kept in mind, there is no true music, but only an infernal clamor and ranting. The name of the power that moves you
Hello,
is
Nicole.
Not important.
Yeah, this takes 58 minutes or so. I'm able to skip the first like minute or so because there's wiggle room on when you can start it.
Is the foundation of religion.
But it's still gonna take some time. How's everyone's day? I'm glad to see that I've bled like less than 10% of my viewers during my literal half hour food break.
The art of flight. Computer games are barely 40 years old. Only a few words in our basic vocabulary have been established.
Yep, after this there's just clouds and endgame, as far as I know.
To be coined.
Your only loss versus Sea King, nice.
Is clean. Someday soon, perhaps even in our lifetime,
if I still want to do more Witness stuff after this run, I'll probably just do Challenge Streak.
Like lightning.
Because I'm on a 3-win streak right now, and I think I figured out the pillars. I think I now know how to solve the pillars, like, algorithmically.
Scholars will pick it apart.
It's pretty exciting.
Decades, perhaps centuries. It will be something wonderful. Something
good to hear him as a turtle.
Something awful.
I get it.
A few years ago, I was invited to speak at a conference in London. My wife joined me, and we took a day.
So how do I get to clouds from here?
We decided to visit England's second biggest tourist attraction, Stratford.
I think I go out behind me.
It was cold and rainy.
Like past the shipping container through bamboo.
Most of the attractions.
And go around counterclockwise around the mountain. Make that work. Love you too, Sundells.
A charming old house along the main street, which attracts millions of pilgrims every year, despite the complete lack of any evidence that Shakespeare was born there or even lived anywhere
Clouds,
near it.
The entrance to Clouds is on the literal other side of the mountain, so I don't really think it matters much which path I take. I'm also going to have to wait up to 13 minutes for Clouds after this, because I don't know what part of the cycle we're on right now.
The rustic country farm where his wife spent her childhood. Although no record shows anyone by that name ever.
Jonathan Blow is like in his 40s,
I think.
We came I'm actually gonna look him up.
Location,
I like Jonathan Blow. He makes good games and he gives good talks.
Trinity Parish
Church, he is a good game designer.
On the banks of the River Avon, where a man by that name is buried. This beautiful church is approached
not
by
there
a long
yet.
Walkway.
Born 1971.
Ancient gravestones.
Oh dang. He's like
tall trees.
Yeah, he's
the
45.
Door is surprisingly tiny.
As I thought.
No cameras are allowed inside. The interior is dark and quiet.
Unfortunately, I can't alt tab out.
The presence of busloads.
Like the game still goes, but I think it's like time dilated so it runs more slowly. If you alt tab out.
Seated in the pews.
And I don't want to risk like anything.
Leads up the center.
Also, for some reason, Botnack is not word wrapping correctly, so if people type really long, really long things in chat, it doesn't wrap correctly. So I can't actually read, like, some of what people are typing. Which is weird, because it didn't do that before, I don't think. It's a problem. But I also haven't updated Botnack, so I don't know why.
Dire warning. Good friend.
331 was Azure's cloud cycle. We should have a good cloud cycle then, because it's about like 14 minutes, 15 minutes.
Who spares
Wait.
These stones.
331.
Cursed be he.
Never mind. I think we're gonna be like, oh, this isn't good. This
every
isn't good.
Year, 3 million pilgrims arrive from every nation on
we're,
Earth.
We're gonna be close. To we're either gonna get there like right as the clouds are about to disperse, or we're gonna get there a couple minutes after they already have, and we'll have to wait 10 more minutes.
As awesome. By contrast, the right side of the altar is dark and featureless. Nobody of any consequence is buried there. The only point of interest is a wooden case of simple design, carved of dark oak. Inside the case, sealed beneath a thick sheet of glass, lies a large open book. A plaque on the case identifies this book as a first edition of the King James Bible, published in 1611, when Shakespeare was 46. Not many pilgrims.
Oh, Checker's practicing spy party against Canadian bacon.
Most of those that do simply
nice.
Glance at the book, read the plaque. And
that might be the raid target, actually.
A few.
I'll probably do some
note that the
challenge
Bible
runs, though.
To be opened to a page
actually, I'm curious, because I haven't actually tried it. Can you restart the challenge after you've already
46.
Done it? Like, on the same save file?
No explanation is
I assume you can, but I've never actually tried.
Choice of pages. For the initiated, none is necessary. If you are of inquisitive bent, if you are intrigued
All right.
by English
I thought so.
And literature, if you value your peace of mind.
Alright, so I guess sub 3 hours is the goal for this run. That is doable.
A scholar noticed
that is doable.
About the King James translation of Psalm 46.
Because I lost, like, a couple minutes at least to boat shenanigans.
Something wonderful.
Are you done yet?
The 46th word from the beginning of Psalm 46 is shake.
Shakespeare, boys.
The 46th word from the end
Shakespeare.
Is spear. There are only two possibilities here. Either this is the finest coincidence ever recorded in the history of world literature, or it is not. The Earth
he is accurately
one sun.
Is accurately defined the possibility one. Space.
The moon happens to be 400 times smaller than the sun.
We're almost
the sun
there.
Happens to be 400 times
we are mere minutes away.
and the apparent
from this eclipse moving over a few pixels. In our sky, I did miss donations. I will read them after the run, because I can't actually alt-tab to scroll down on them. I will do so, though. I see that Golfer donated something. I think somebody else did, but it's off my screen now. Oh, Jesus. 303 a cloud cycle. Because that's totally possible. That's totally possible. We're so close. I'm keeping my fingers very, very far away from the actual mouse buttons because misclicking would... I don't know. I don't know what I'd do. I'm actually scared to touch my mouse now. Actually, I can just use controller. I can literally just like hold down on controller and nothing can possibly go wrong. Just hold down on controller. We'll get there. The first wife of Henry VIII. Are we there? I don't actually know like what line ends it. Cast the shadow of the cross upon the grassy hillside. At exactly 12 noon, the man. You think it's more like 3:05? A bar magnet. God. He turned the magnet so its north pole was facing south.
Come on.
And
buried it under the shadow of the cross.
Come on, dude.
2 years later, a few hours before the publication of his first book, the man returned to that hillside.
It's right there.
This time.
It's right there. I can feel it.
He used a compass to
locate
the magnet he had buried.
I can feel
in
it
that same place,
in my bones.
He dug a hole in the
ground. This is less than 58 minutes.
Placed inside a ceramic container inscribed
one last try.
The following words. I am the keeper of the jewel of master.
Here it is. Here it is.
Lies waiting safe inside me.
We did it. We did it. Also, Whataburger is delicious. Let's see, what is our cloud situation? If I see clouds moving to the left, I missed it. If I see it moving to the right, then it's about to hit. From the perspective of the mountain. Shut up. God. Game! Lag in this game is awful. Oh my goodness. One frame a second. Okay, okay, okay. Stare at the ground. Golden eye strats, golden eye strats. Save the frames. Save the frames. Alright, we are not on the cloud cycle. Cloud cycle is nowhere near. We did not narrowly miss it, and we did not narrowly hit it. I don't actually know when it'll come again. And there's nothing to do but wait for it. I could do the mountain stuff. How many minutes do you... You're betting on an 11-minute wait? That's possible. If it's an 11-minute wait, I can go down and solve all the pillars. Have I solved the pillars yet? I have. I have solved the pillars. Yes. Actually, I can just check. Hello? 522, 134. Yep, okay. We have solved everything except the elevator and this. I wonder if we could do Hall of the Mountain King while we're waiting. That would be fun. 3-0 win versus Azuri. Not bad. Not bad at all. So yeah, we do this, and then we do elevator, and then I practice some Hall of the Mountain King. It'll be great. It'll be amazing. Alright, we need to figure out cloud cycles. It's really important. It's so important. It's literally costing full minutes not knowing cloud cycles. Actually, I can read donations now. I will attempt to alt-tab out of the game and then alt-tab back into it. Hopefully it works. All right, I've received... God, can I even alt-tab back into the witness? Oh my goodness, what? What? Okay, everything minimized. Literally everything. I think we're good now. We're still good, okay. Let's, splicing. I was not splicing, I swear. Alright. It didn't crash, we're fine. I've received $2.50 from John Cena. He says, I am here to disrupt the run. I approve of the John Cena meme. If any of you guys have not yet followed... I'm gonna find the exact link. Because I seriously want you guys to find this Twitter account. Alright, it is at WWE Subway. At WWE Subway. It is the greatest. It details the Subway experience with GIFs from WWE. It's great. It is fantastic. It also has John Cena. We also have $20 from Golfer777 saying that he respects the not-so-subtle shilling. I have learned from the best, and the best is Azure. I'm also shilling for a Twitter account, so there you go. Where are the clouds? They're like over there. We have slight rightward movement. This cloud is moving to the right. Can you see it? It's moving to the right. It's happening. This cloud is saving the speedrun. It is faster than the Braid Cloud. That is true. Well, the Braid Cloud is actually easier to see moving, I think. It just has a lot farther to go. Oh yeah, the audio diary on top of the mountain. I remember activating that in my Let's Play and staring awkwardly at the screen while she wouldn't shut up. Let's do it. I wonder if activating the elevator interrupts playing audio diary. I don't actually know. If only I could remember where it was. Only I could remember. Where is it? Where is it? By the podium. This is a podium. They patched it. Thank goodness. Am I missing Cloud Cycle right now? I don't think so. But I'm a little bit nervous, so I'm gonna like make sure. Right now I'm really nervous. Right now I'm gonna make sure. Say it ain't so. I don't think it was coming up. Takes a long time. And you can see it happening. Okay, the cycle is coming together. It's not there yet. What's the fastest way down to the elevator? I don't think you actually go through the mountain. I think it is faster to go through secret area. Yes. I think it's faster to go through secret area. Yeah, through the cave by the marsh was my plan. Alright, so there... It comes together at 3:15, which is 195 minutes. We suspect it's about a 14-minute cycle. 195 divided by 14. That should give us a pretty accurate idea of exactly where it is. Right. 195 divided by 14. Yeah, so it's like, that was the... So that should be like the 14th cycle or the 13th cycle. So divide 195 by like 14 or 13, and that is the interval. Yeah, 13.9. 13.9 minutes is the interval, I think. We can figure it out. Yeah, this is super fast. This is definitely fastest way. Alright, are you guys ready? We're about to beat the video game. I beat the video game. 195 divided by 13 is exactly 15. That's a good point. It's either exactly 15 minutes, or it is 13.9 minutes. There's a little bit of pausing that I did during the run, but I don't think that'll matter. But there was also lag, which might matter.
Just look at Fearful Ferret, the gaming god.
So it's about there. So this is world record. I don't know what Azrae got, but it was probably like an hour slower than this. This is 3:16. I waited like 5 minutes for clouds, and I waited 58 minutes for eclipse, but that's totally normal. Eclipse actually takes 55 and a half minutes, because you can cut off the first like 2 minutes, and you can cut off the last like half minute or something like that. So eclipse is not actually 58, it's 55 and a half. And right now, Azrae, I'm not rating you yet. I'm still gonna do challenge streaks, but maybe. Wow, world record's already updated. Good job, BTM. If Azrae does not beat this tonight, I'll put it on YouTube like tomorrow, but I'll also be doing a lot more runs. The main thing I can improve is just knowing cloud intervals, because knowing when to do that is important. And yeah, the game is like lagging terribly during elevator cutscene. I'm not making you do this, dude. I gave you 2 days to beat it. That was my challenge, not 2 hours. Come on. Should we wait through this whole thing? I feel like we shouldn't. I mean, for completion's sake, I guess we'll wait on it.
Flash of lightning. Summer cloud.
A flash of lightning in a summer cloud.
Shakespeare. You can look around, I suppose. I wish you could actually, like, left click and solve puzzles during this, and you could actually like finish out the last puzzles while you're flying. Just like the environmental stuff, like hedge mazes. That would be fun. Thanks, Vavasaur. Yeah, letting endings play out after a speedrun is good. Like, people watched speedruns instead of Let's Plays on occasion. Like, it is a subset of Let's Plays. And endings are part of games. Well, this isn't the ending. There's a different ending, which is much better. That we don't get in this run. Wait a second. So, does the developer ending count as an ending for the purposes of being at an end of the speedrun? Answer me that. Right? If I ended with the It Is All a Dream speedrun ending, or whatever you call it, does that count? Do you have to do elevator, or can you do the other one? Because I like the other ending a lot more. This one is just like, what a pretty island we made. Let's say some random sentences, and then crash the game. I actually want the game to close, because that seems to fix lag for a while. You do have to do elevator for a puzzle, but you can easily do elevator like while you're next to it. Because I think it's faster to... Let's see. Actually, no, it's still faster to get to elevator. Never mind.
A phantom.
A phantom.
Phantom.
There is a puzzle on the Dream Bridge, but it does not count towards total number of solves. I tried it. I probably won't be doing the other ending on stream. It's not too difficult to get yourself if you know how. If you reload the game, then it just spawns you inside the elevator and you can open up the doors and walk out. But yeah, the game crashes like now. I don't know if you can noclip in the developer ending. I've never used noclip in this game. I'm not sure it's active in this current version. If you save and quit or reload the game, it just like makes a save right where you stopped and continues there. It is meant to crash. Like, the game will literally close just about now.
A dream.
And a dream.
And a dream. And a dream.